Well, brothers and sisters, today we are starting part 5 of our series on the nature and character of God. And today we are talking about God's righteousness, his faithfulness, and his justice. Now, that's a big topic to cover. And you'll find that a lot of the things that we talk about throughout this series, they kind of overlap, they intertwine. Right? You can't really talk about God's mercy without talking about his love and his righteousness and justice and holiness. And that is because, of course, our God is a unified God. He is one God. He is a coherent and consistent being. Right? You can't separate out individual characteristics as if you could remove one and God would still be pretty much the same minus that one characteristic. You can't do that any more than you could remove some of my characteristics or some of your characteristics and say that that person hasn't changed, right? God, of course, does not change. He is the same yesterday, today, and forever. And so when we talk about the nature and character of God, we talk about all these things together. But before we get too far into things, we want to, as we have done throughout this whole series, we want to give a shout out to Karen Sari of the Infographics Bible, the one who created the Infographics Bible, and thank her once again for giving us the opportunity to have this particular graphic recreated and to use it. We're so grateful for that. Also, during this particular message, we are going to hear again from the Bible Project. This is this great project. This is this nonprofit animation studio that puts out videos to help us understand the Bible. And so we're going to get to watch a little bit of one of their videos today. And so we're grateful for that as well. So as always, we want to remember that the nature and character of God is in the context of God's love, like God is love, and God's holiness and perfection. And as we zoom in on faithfulness, righteousness, and justice, we see also that this is in the category of God's moral character. In other words, these are the things about God that have to do with whether God is good or whether God is evil. Of course, God is good, and so these characteristics all fit firmly in the good category. And that's important to remember, because when we get to, for example, God's wrath, you will all have to remember that God's wrath is not a bad thing. God's wrath is not some secret corner of evil that is tucked into the otherwise good character of God. No, no, God's wrath is part of the good and morally righteous character of God. For today, we're talking about God's righteousness, faithfulness, and justice. And the first passage we are going to look at comes from Deuteronomy chapter 7, verses 7 to 9. God's faithfulness. The Lord did not set his affection on you. Here, the writer of Deuteronomy, Moses, is talking to the people of Israel. He's speaking to the people of Israel, but it's very much true for us as well today. The Lord did not set his affection on you and choose you because you were more numerous than other peoples, for you were the fewest of all peoples. But it was because the Lord loved you and kept the oath he swore to your ancestors that he brought you out with a mighty hand and redeemed you from the land of slavery, from the power of Pharaoh, king of Egypt. Know, therefore, that the Lord your God is God. He is the faithful God, keeping his covenant of love to 1,000 generations of those who love him and keep his commandments. Our God is a faithful God. This is one of the reasons that the promises of the Bible stand out so importantly and significantly for believers. For if we could not rely on the promises of God, if God was not faithful, then we'd be in big trouble. We'd have a capricious God, a God who said, yeah, you know what? Today I feel like being nice to you, so you're in luck. But tomorrow, maybe not, right? That is a scary thought to contemplate, a God that might just change his mind like that. But that means he is also faithful in his righteousness and justice. He does not neglect his own righteousness and justice. We see in Psalm 89 and so many other places in the Bible, we see about God's righteousness. Psalm 89, verse 14. Righteousness and justice are the foundation of your throne. Love and faithfulness go before you. Now, in this little snippet of Psalm 89, we see all of these characteristics of God and more beside. We see righteousness and justice and faithfulness as well, right? And notice that the psalmist does not see these things as in any way problematic to put together, right? The psalmist doesn't say, you know, righteousness and justice are there, but love and faithfulness, they're deeply troublesome and contradictory sometimes to righteousness and justice, and so it's weird conflict. No, of course not. The psalmist doesn't say that. Instead, the psalmist puts those things together. Like we said last week, they're like peanut butter and jam. They go well together, right? And so we continue on to God's justice. And in Psalm 33, verse 5, we read about God's justice. The Lord loves righteousness and justice. The earth is full of his unfailing love. The Lord loves righteousness and justice. Our God is not just a God who is going through the motions of righteousness and justice and faithfulness. Our God is a God who loves those things, who is excited about those things. I remember my first year going to university. I had the distinct pleasure of going and privilege of going to Trinity Western University, which, for those of you who don't know, is a Christian liberal arts university like Redeemer. And I remember going there, and I had gone to Christian schools for my whole life. And yet, when I got to Trinity Western University, my first year dorm was full of young men who loved God and who wanted to do justice and to live righteous lives. And they were, in my opinion, cool. They were amazing guys. They had incredible talents and abilities. They had a heart to do amazing things. They were fun. They enjoyed life thoroughly. And these guys, it was the first time in my life that I had seen young men whom I could look up to, who also loved God and loved righteousness and justice, and it changed my world. And this is what the Lord our God is like. He doesn't just do what he has to do, but he loves righteousness and justice. Now we come to look at another passage, which sort of, even though not all of the characteristics are mentioned explicitly in this passage, they are all contained within it, the concept of those things. We come to this passage, Exodus chapter 34, verses 6 to 7, because it is so key. It is quoted multiple times in the scriptures. In fact, this is the most quoted and referenced scripture passage in all of the rest of the Bible. And so we want to look at this. This is what it says in the New International Version 2011. The Lord, the compassionate and gracious God, slow to anger, abounding in love and faithfulness, maintaining love to thousands, and forgiving wickedness, rebelliousness, and sin. Rebellion and sin. Yet he does not leave the guilty unpunished. He punishes the children and their children for the sin of the parents to the third and fourth generation. Now, I want you to take a few moments to watch this first clip from the Bible Project video about this particular passage and looking at the character of God.
The Bible is a collection of many ancient Israelite scrolls, and together they're telling one unified story.
Now, if you look at the second scroll, Exodus, you'll find two important sentences. They're actually so important that they're referenced and requoted over 20 more times within the Bible itself.
It must be important. What does it say?
Yahweh, Yahweh, that's God's name, a God compassionate and gracious, slow to anger, overflowing with loyal love and faithfulness.
I can see why it's repeated so often. These attributes of God are really lovely.
And the statement goes on. He maintains loyal love for thousands, forgiving iniquity, transgression, and sin. Yet he won't declare innocent the guilty. He will bring the iniquities of the fathers upon the children and grandchildren to the third and the fourth.
Okay, hold on. This last part takes a bit of a turn. We're first talking about God's love, and suddenly it's about his judgment on grandkids. So is God merciful or vengeful?
Yeah, great question.
So that clip of the Bible Project video leaves us with this question. Is God merciful or is God just? And it's a good question, right? For example, when we think of God's faithfulness, is God going to be faithful to us? Or is he going to exact his judgment, his righteous justice upon us? The answer to this question, so is God merciful or is God just, is yes. That's the answer to this question. God is both. God is both merciful and just. If we look at the story that surrounds this little passage of Exodus 34 verses 6 to 7, the passage we just read, we can see how this works out. You see, this is in the setting of God having brought the people of Israel out of Egypt, having rescued them from under the thumb of Pharaoh and the Egyptians, having brought them through the Red Sea and miraculously parted the waters for them to walk on dry ground, and brought them, God has brought them to the foot of Mount Sinai, where they are to make covenant with God. They are to be his people, and he to be their God and their sovereign king. And they're going to camp at the foot of Mount Sinai for about a year, and they're going to talk with God and see what God has to say and work out the sort of the terms of the covenant agreement between them and God. So God initiates the covenant conversation with Moses, and one of the first things he does is he gives these two commandments, right? These two commandments, don't worship any other gods, and don't make any idols of God. right? Don't make any idols and worship them. Don't make any idols or images of God. That's not okay either. So God makes this part of the covenant, and this is all part of the grand ceremony of the people of Israel becoming the covenant people of God. And that is where, in the story, we find the description of God's character in Exodus chapter 34, verses 6 to 7. And watch to see what happens.
The story that has our description about God's character. The story begins with Moses going up on the mountain, writing down the partner agreement, as the Israelites are at the base of the mountain, violating the first two commands.
That's ridiculous. They're breaking the covenant vows while the ceremony is still going on.
Yes. And so God is hurt and angry, and he warns Moses that this betrayal will keep on happening. God is ready to call it quits.
But what about his promise to rescue the world through them?
Yeah, exactly. This is what Moses brings up. And so, what is God gonna do? Should he end the partnership, which would be fair?
Or will he be faithful to his promise to Abraham and show them mercy?
You see, the people of Israel, they end up breaking the covenant before the ceremony is even finished. They're in the process of becoming a people of God who are supposed to demonstrate who God is to the nations. And even in the midst of that, they are breaking the covenant. And God rightfully and justly, you know, is pretty much at the point where he says, that's it, right? They can't even last a few days with my covenant. Forget it. But Moses pleads for them. And the big question is, what will God do? Will God be merciful, or will he cancel the agreement with the people of Israel, the covenant with the people of Israel, which would be just and righteous? And this, in the middle of this, is where we find this description. And I've reformatted it a bit to be a poem, which is how it should be. Like, that's how it's structured in the original Hebrew language. It's a poem, and it's a poem with a very particular structure. You'll notice here that the third line is indented the furthest, slow to anger. And the seventh line is also indented the furthest. Yet he does not leave the guilty unpunished. This is incredibly important for our understanding of God. God is not one who quickly gets angry and punishes people righteously and justly, though that may be. God is slow to anger. He is patient and merciful. He is patient and merciful, but people can't get away with whatever they want. That's not the way it works. We have one more clip to look at. And then we'll come back and talk about a little bit more about what that means for us.
God maintains loyal love for thousands. And how is he going to remain loyal to people who keep rebelling against him? By forgiving iniquity, transgression, and sin.
But God's forgiveness doesn't mean people can just do whatever they want.
Right. God's mercy is balanced in what follows. Yet he won't declare innocent the guilty. He'll bring the iniquities of the fathers upon the children and grandchildren to the third and the fourth.
The third and the fourth what?
Well, it's referring to generations of people who repeat their ancestors' rebellion against God. They'll get what they deserve. But notice, this small number of generations contrasts that massive number up above.
So while God is slow to anger, he is also just.
Right. This is the tension that these two sentences are exploring. How does a faithful and loyal God deal with such a rebellious people? This is the challenge God faces in this story, and it's the same challenge he faces in the whole biblical story as he works to rescue the world through this family.
The question that comes up, as always, is what does God's character have to do with us in this case? Well, first of all, we need to be grateful. Obviously, we need to be grateful, extremely grateful for God's faithfulness to us and to his promises in spite of our sin. This is not, of course, only true for the people of Israel, but it is just as true for us as well. God is faithful to us and to his promises, even in spite of our sin. And that is something that we can never be grateful enough for, but that we can always grow in our gratitude. Also, we need to be grateful that God is just indeed, and we cannot get away with whatever we want. That's important, right? What kind of a parent would say, you know, hey, it's fine, kid, do whatever you want. Doesn't matter to me, right? That would not be great for that kid's upbringing. How would they learn what is right and wrong? How would they learn what to do and what not to do? How would they learn any sense of justice and righteousness? They couldn't. And so, too, we need to be grateful that God is indeed just and righteous. We need to be grateful about that righteousness as well. It is important to us that God has standards that are true and good. If God was not good, if God was not consistent in his righteousness, or if he was downright evil, we would be the most desperate of people. God is indeed good in all the senses of the word. But what about for how we live? What about for how we live? What does God's character, his faithfulness, righteousness, and justice have to do with us? Well, it has to do with us in that, once again, we are God's image bearers. We were created to love just as God is love. We were created to love. And part of that is to live out all of these characteristics, faithfulness and righteousness and justice. So first of all, we can grow in our faithfulness. The example of God, our Heavenly Father, and even more, the example of Jesus Christ, who came and showed us what it means to be faithful in its fullness, that example is there for us to follow, to mature in, and through the work of the Holy Spirit and through studying the scriptures and so on, we can grow in our faithfulness. And so first, we need to be faithful to God. We can't be wandering around, oh, I'm going to serve God today and I'm going to serve myself tomorrow. That's fine, right? Oh, of course not. That would be terrible. One of the most heinous things that we can think of is a husband or a wife being unfaithful to their spouse, or a friend being unfaithful to a friend. Faithfulness is a key characteristic for us as Christ followers, and indeed it is a key characteristic of what we were meant to be as human beings. Second, we need to be faithful to our fellow human beings. That's why it's so upsetting when people are unfaithful friends or unfaithful spouses. We need to be faithful. We get to grow in our faithfulness to our fellow image bearers. And we get to grow in our faithfulness to this world, this creation. I know we often don't think about that, but there is a covenant relationship between us and creation. God set us up to be his sovereigns in this world, to care for it and to tend it. And so we have an obligation to be faithful to the creation that God has made and put us in charge of. Secondly, we need to image God in how we grow in righteousness, right? How we grow in righteousness. We grow in righteousness by following the command of love, of course, which Jesus made very clear was the most important command. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength, and love your neighbor as yourself. And then we work that out through our obedience to God's other commands. Our obedience, for example, to the Ten Commandments. That is, how we work out righteousness in the context of love and in obedience to God's commands. And we can grow in our righteousness also by studying the scriptures. And I'm not talking about studying the scriptures just like you would study for a math exam. I'm talking about studying the scriptures and implementing what they teach in our lives, living out true knowledge, which is head, heart, and hands. And lastly, we can image God by growing in our justice, right? By living justly in our own lives, by not being self-centered, by not being unduly centered on someone else to their own detriment, by not being focused on my own needs exclusively, by acting, in short, justly in all the areas of our lives. But not only in living justly in our lives, but also by advocating for justice in our world, both in words and in deeds. One of the biggest things that the prophets spoke about throughout the Old Testament were justice issues, about how the various religious and spiritual leadership camps of Israel would be oppressing the foreigner, oppressing the widow, oppressing the orphan, oppressing the poor, right? And God speaks through his prophets about this issue over and over and over again. I have always loved that the GEMS organization has chosen Micah 6 verse 8 as their theme verse. What does the Lord require of you but to do justice and to love mercy and to walk humbly with your God? And so we can grow in imaging God in our justice as well. Brothers and sisters, we serve a God who is faithful and righteous and just. And we too are called to be faithful and righteous and just. We can be so eternally grateful for God's justice for us, for God's righteousness to us, and for God's faithfulness to us. And our gratitude can show itself in our words and in our deeds as we live in his image. Let's pray. Father in heaven, thank you so much for these characteristics of yours, your faithfulness, righteousness, and justice. Oh God, help us to live out those things in our own lives, even as we walk in gratitude for those characteristics in you. Thank you for the example of your Son who teaches us all about living out faithfulness and righteousness and justice. Thank you so much for the reality of your Spirit within us, which teaches us how to live that way. Thank you so much for the example of your prophets and those who have come before who have spoken faithfully about these things. Lord, we pray, help us. Help us to be like you in this. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.